Now, in UI/UX Essential session, we have covered the UI part in our earlier session. So, in today's session, we are going to focus more on the user experience part, that is UX. Now, can anyone tell me what's the difference between user interface and user experience?
User experience, when any product or any thing is created, like how a user like how the navigation, how the experience from using the product. So that is user experience.
Perfect. So what happens in UI and user experience is in UI we determine what the UI would look like. So we don't give much emphasis on the interaction aspect in that particular software product or software system. So we are just focused on the user interface part, like what would be the look and feel of that particular user screen, what options would be put under which drop down, what option would be there in the menu or checkbox and radio button. We essentially do not focus on the user experience part. Now, user experience, if I say that a particular user is frustrated with your particular application. Now, frustrated is something, a very vague term. Now, frustration has different implications. Now, frustration can arise out due to of the user incapable of interacting with the particular system efficiently, or he may be finding it difficult to locate or discover a navigation option in that particular user screen. So we have to learn those user interaction or user behavior in a particular system. So essentially what happens in a particular software product, if you have seen, Microsoft keeps launching their Office version every 3 years or 2 years. Now what they essentially do, the features are almost pretty much the same thing that the older version is offering, but they change the user experience part. Now how they come to know that this particular user experience is needed for this particular software product. So this comes from the surveys that they conduct with the user community. They tend to understand what are the features that they feel that the user should be having on under which tab. Under which tab this option should be presented to a particular user. So they are enhancing the user experience of that particular product. On top of that, they are coming up with intuitive user screens as well. If you see a product that has been launched 5 years back would not be having that much intuitive screen than the product that is recently launched. The user intuitiveness of that particular screen also plays a very important role when it comes to user experience. So whenever a new product is launched in a particular market, they focus more on the both the aspect, the user interface part, the UI has to be very intuitive and very connecting in nature, and the user experience part, how easy the user can navigate through the different screens. Now, a very common example would be the various login mechanism for a particular web application. Now, a web application is having a particular login mechanism and registration mechanism. Now, why these website these days are using login via Facebook or login via Google Plus or login via Twitter? Because that gives the user to maintain the same credential that they have in Facebook application and Twitter application. With the same credential, they can log into that particular website as well. So they need not to remember the same username, I mean different username and password for every different website they visit. So that's the reason why they create those kind of option to enhance the user experience so that the user is very much comfortable using their application and they don't have to remember so many usernames and password for that particular application. Now, in our today's session, we are going to cover what is user experience design, the best approaches for user experience design, the user experience design process, and the 6 stages in user experience design process. Now, what is user experience design? So, user experience design, UXD or UED or simply UX, is the process of enhancing user satisfaction with a product by improving the usability, accessibility, and pleasure provided in the interaction with the particular product. Now, how comfortable the users are in terms of accessing your particular system, that is what defines your user experience. Now, developing a user experience to the level of customer satisfaction is not a single person or team's responsibility. Instead, it's a company's vision. So these all decisions around creating a exceptional user experience is not an individual decision for a particular person or a particular team. It's a company's vision, the company who launched this particular product. Now, why user experience design really matters? If you consider Steve Jobs' statement, what he says that design is not just what it looks like and feels like. Design is how it works. What is the screen? Now, if you consider an iOS application driven phone, the user experience is exceptional in those phones. The user experience is very minimalistic and very simple. The user, the moment he grabs the phone in his hand, he tends to understand what the functionality would be. Now, when we say functionality, it's not like we create a functionality and the user is clueless about what this functionality does. So, what Apple has done in their particular iOS application, they have signified the functionality with the respective icons. For example, if you see a dialer symbol, that means that symbol signifies you can make and receive a call via that particular feature. If there is a message symbol, that signifies that you can read, send, and receive the messages via that particular feature. If there is an email symbol, that signifies that you can receive and send emails via that particular feature. So this icon plays a very important role when it comes to make your design simplified for the user experience. You don't have to write those 50 sentences describing that particular feature. A one single icon is sufficient to convey the message that what this functionality or feature would be doing. That is what they did in Apple phone. Now, if you consider great user experience design not only highlights and promotes your product, it has become a key part of building and growing customer confidence. If your customer are very much confident about the user experience, then only they would be interested in buying the next upgrade of that particular system. If the user experience is not good, then I won't look into that particular product. Now, coming to that process modeling tool, we have Visio, we have Gliffy, we have Lucidchart, we have n number of XYZ process modeling tool. Now, what plays an important aspect over here is user experience. How well we are able to locate the necessary stencils in those particular software suites. Then only we would decide whether we should continue or we should subscribe to this particular product or not. So user experience plays a very important role when it comes to choosing between a particular product which are offering the same functionality which your competitors are offering. We have to consider the user experience to be as simple as possible for the user community. Because if they don't like the product, they won't buy it or they won't pay for a monthly subscription, whichever your marketing team has decided. Now, a great product or compelling content without an appealing user experience may affect the ability of an organization to achieve its business goal. Like your organization has heavily invested in that particular software product, and the software product is exceptional. Its functionalities are very, way good in terms of market demands, but the user experience is poor. People are unable to understand the functionalities or the features your product is offering. So your product would be hampered by those particular situation. So that not only impacts the team which you are working or that set of people who are working for development of that particular product, rather they impact the organization's business goal, why they have launched that particular product. Now, there are certain approaches for user experience design, certain best approaches for your user experience design. Like good user experience design is always part of your product development process. So you interact with your user to build the unique combination of structure, content, and user experience. Now, when we build a particular user experience, we have to holistically look into the structure of that particular application, the content that we put in that particular application, the icons, the images, the text that describe those features. We have to be very skeptical about it because that ultimately leads to our overall product success. If we are unable to understand or unable to put those things into user's mind, then user won't buy that particular product. It's as simple as that. So the primary factor of success lies in the fact that you keep your user in center of your design process. So whoever is the end user who would be using your particular product, you have to put that user in picture, and then according to that particular user persona, you have to design your user experience. So this approach allows you to create designs that are clean, simple, intuitive, flexible, and engaging, that provides a wow experience to your users and thus differentiate you from other competitors. So if your design is simple, clean, intuitive, flexible, and engaging, then only your user would be interested in your particular product, and they won't go to your particular competitors. So most often what this product manager and product owner does before designing the user experience, they tend to survey a group of users. Now, these surveys are not free. What they do, they run marketing campaigns and they reward the user for participating in those particular surveys. Now, once they receive the necessary feedback, they tend to enhance or model their user experience basis on the feedback they have received out of these surveys. Now, what is the user experience design process? Now, user experience design process is developed in six stages. First, we need to understand the user experience. We need to understand the requirements. We need to create user personas, and we need to define the use cases. In the second stage, we have to research, wherein we analyze our competitors. We research the latest user experience trends that are available in the market, and we have to keep an eye on the guidelines. Now, this user experience, they tend to change over a period of time. Every 3 years, you would see a new trend of user experience. For example, the hamburger menu in Android application. Now, that has gone a norm at this point of time. Now, imagine a scenario 5 years back. We didn't extensively use that hamburger menu in our Android applications. That was not a trend at that point of time. So these user experience trends, they keep on evolving every 3 years, and you have to match up with that particular trend. You, along with your product, have to evolve as per the current market trend. It's not like that you developed a particular user experience today and at a later point of time, you would forget it and you would stop contributing to the user experience. No, this two aspect has to go in line. The aspect around your functionalities and the feature, and the aspect around the UI screen and the user experience, both has to keep on evolving. It's not that only functionality and the only user experience. If you give a particular product which is just an wow UI, and there are lame features in that particular application which was offered 10 years ago, people won't be interested in buying it. And at the same time, on the contrary, if you give them a application which is rich in feature and the UI is lame, very dull in looking, and the user experience is poor, people won't be buying those applications. So these two aspects has to go hand on hand, the feature, the functionality, along with the UI and the user experience. So that we can conclude only with the help of research that we conduct along with our market competitors. After that, the third stage is sketching stage, wherein we gather ideas, we draw sketches and wireframes, and evaluate and redraw these sketches until and unless we are not convinced that it would work out for us or the product as a whole. Once the sketch is ready, we go with the design phase, wherein we design images, we create prototypes, we define user experience guideline, like what option would be where, on click of this button, what pop-up would open, under that pop-up, what option would be there. If I click on option one, what is the action or the functionality the user should be shown? If I click on button two, what's the action or the functionality the user would be able to do? How the scrolling effect would be there? Will it be an infinite scroll or will it be a scroll up to 10 items? So those kind of things would be defined in your user experience guidelines. After we have done that, we go to the fifth stage, that is implement stage, wherein we implement the functionality and build the experience. So this user experience and the functionalities, the core functionality, they go hand on hand. But here, when we talk about implementation, it's about implementing the user experience functionality. It's not the core functionality that the application is offering, like the click of the button, breadcrumb, hamburger menu. These are the functionalities that we need to develop when we talk about implementation of the user experience. Now, once we are done with that, we go for evaluation, wherein we perform usability testing, create audit reports, and identify improvement. Now, this evaluation is a continuity process which happens over a period of time, and basis on the feedback that we receive from the respective user community, we go about developing those feedback into our respective application. Now, let us understand these stages in detail. Now, in stage one, we need to understand the user experience process. So here we design, solve a problem. In order to provide a solution, you first need to understand a particular problem. So before beginning the design work, let your design team understand the requirements clearly. Here we need to talk clearly with our design team that what is our requirement, what is the end goal of our application, who are the target customer, who all would be using this application. We need to clearly communicate to the design team. Basis on these communication, the design team would come up with their what I would say findings. Now here we analyze requirements. We follow industry standard user research methods, including contextual and individual interviews while observing the users in real environment. So let's say if we are having an application which is in similar line, we need to understand what are the cons of those application and how they could be improvised in the newer releases. So that serves as the base for our research. Now we conduct brainstorming session with the customers and show them our existing product if there are any to get their feedback. Here we also interact with the customer to understand their feedback around their usage of the older application that we offered them in the similar line. The business manager here plays a role wherein he works directly with the customer and gets requirement from them. Then design team works closely with the business managers to understand users and their needs. So here the knowledge about user and his environment help us to provide a clear direction to our design, what we are intending to achieve. Like it is said, to be a great designer, you need to look a little deeper into how people think and act. So we need to understand what would be the behavior of the people when it comes to designing a particular application. So here the stakeholder involved would be your design team, the business manager, and the product manager when it comes to understanding the design, user experience design process. The activities that we do in this stage is we meet, we talk, we observe and understand users in their environment. We analyze requirement to understand and clarify them. We define user personas and use cases. And the outcomes that we get out of this stage are user personas, user stories, use cases, and user flows. Now, this is the user persona, and this is a what I would say screen flow for a particular application. Now, I have already explained you user personas. Can anyone explain me what is user persona?
It's like understanding what the user wants to achieve from the project, like what are the end goals, and understanding from their perspective what they need.
Yes, absolutely. So we would walk into their shoes and we would understand, like we have a user persona over here, document designer and content creator. We need to understand how they would be interacting with the application. What would be the way of their behavior in that particular application. Essentially, how would be the user experience for them in the particular application? Because every user cannot be given the same user experience. Depending on the nature of the user, we have to customize our user experience. The way a document designer interact with a system would be completely different the way the content creator interacts with the application. So here we need to understand the goal, what they need, what would be their behavior and what they don't need. And we also understand their background. Like Nick is a document designer and Julia is a content creator. So with the help of user persona, we should be able to answer these questions. The next stage is research stage in user experience design process. Now, research is the basic key step to design user experience. So let's say this is this lady Paula. She says, "It took me a few seconds to draw it, but it took me 34 years to learn how to draw it in a few seconds." Now, user experience is not about, you know, concluding things basis on what you feel, because if that being a case, anything could be successful. Any software product would be successful if you feel that your work is correct and your work, if it is promoted to the end customer for their usage, they would accept it. Then you are absolutely wrong. It's not about what you feel right in user experience design process. It's about what other or your end customer feels right. Now, in that particular process, you can create your own design n number of times, but still do not meet the ultimate end goal. Now, how and when can you meet those ultimate end goal? Only by understanding your user. What is their need and what is their expectation out of that particular system? Now, here, a design team does their research work to explore how the outer world is working on such feature. So, an example could be this particular person, Sheriff Amin, product designer, called it a UX competitive analysis. Now, he is performing a UX competitive analysis. Now, he listed three purposes of this analysis. Why he is doing analysis? He need to understand the market competition. He need to learn about the domain. And he need to get inspiration and ideas from your competitors. So in order to solve these three problems, he is doing a competitor analysis. So competitor analysis is a very important aspect which you perform essentially in the product development world, wherein before creating your own product, you need to understand whether the product is actually needed or not at this point of time. Because if the market is overcrowded at this point of time, there's no point in launching a product which is again in similar lines. There is no point. So before that, you need to understand whether the product is actually needed or not. Now, if the product is actually needed, there are hundreds of other vendors offering products in similar lines. What are the exceptional things you are doing? What are the additional value you are giving to the customer? Now, the value cannot be in terms of functionality. It can be in terms of user experience. Maybe the 100 other vendors are complicating the things. The user experience is not that good. You can encash that opportunity in terms of understanding your market competition, wherein you evaluate other vendors' product and you come up with the suggestion and ideas that you could incorporate in your product, which would ultimately make your product successful. After that, you have to keep an eye on the latest UI trends, design principles, and your existing user experience guideline. So if you consider the latest UI trends, there is a huge boom of material design in today's landscape. If you consider today's application, most of the application are involved in the material design framework. Now that is a latest UI trend that is ongoing in the market. If you consider the user experience part, React.js, which is giving a tough competition to Angular.js. Now, AngularJS is something offered by Google and React.js is something offered by Facebook. So they both are competing with each other. But the functionalities that React.js is providing on top of the user experience and UX is way good than your primitive Google framework, that is AngularJS. So you need to understand what are the latest UI trends and the user experience guidelines that are available before starting actually working on the user experience part. Once you are clear with that vision, you can start working on your software product user experience aspect. Now, once you are done with that, while you are doing research, start thinking about possible layouts and option to provide the desired experience. Here we need to understand what would be the layout, where all things would be there, how you would be categorizing, classifying those information, and how you would be presenting to the end customer. So you research from others' application and whatever are the cons you adapt in your application. So in this process, the stakeholder would be the design team. The activities would be study of competitors' approaches, research on similar features in the world, then analysis of latest UI UX trends, design principles and rules, and you have to keep an eye on your own user experience guideline. And the outcome would be a bunch of idea and material on which you can build your actual design work. So these are the ultimate end outcome that you would receive basis on your competitive analysis. Let's say you have 100 products on which you have researched. You would copy a search bar from one particular product. You would copy the upload functionality from one particular product. You would copy the images functionality or the way the image look like from one particular product. You would copy the other aspect from a particular product. So basis on the product or the array of product that you have researched, you would create those lists and you would pick which is the best way of implementing that particular solution into your application. Now, in this particular functionality, we are researching about an upload file functionality. How the upload file functionality would look like in our system, in our user experience design process. Now, if you see the option one, it is having a plus button, add attached file. This is offered by one particular vendor. Now, the other vendor is offering this particular image along with a button, choose file to upload. The third vendor is uploading with this particular file, wherein they are also giving the size of the file along with the upload functionality. The fourth vendor is offering this image only. The fifth vendor is uploading this way. The sixth vendor is uploading this way. Now you have so many options in front of you for exploring your upload file functionality, how you would include upload file functionality in your system. Now you have to study all your competitors' upload file functionality, and basis on your judgment, you have to come up with a solution which you feel the user would be more comfortable with. Now, basis on this all images, I feel the second one is the best option according to me. Now, that doesn't mean that would be the best option for you. So for that reason, what you need to do, you need to run a feedback or go through the feedback received from the end customer, and you can come to a conclusion that what users actually like. Do they like upload functionality this way or this way or this way or this way? So whatever is the feedback, basis on that, you go about implementing that upload functionality into your application. Now the third stage is sketching stage. Now what happens in sketching stage is, here it involves UI definition of required feature. Here design team drives this activity which is based on last two stage of the process. Here we draw paper sketches, whiteboard flows and wireframes to share our ideas with stakeholders. The stage itself is an iterative process. It's not a one-time process. This process keeps on going on a continual basis. So like designing is not something that you just create and start using it, draw and draft and redraw and redraft, thus creating an unmatched experience. So when it comes to user experience, it's not a one-time process. You draw the same thing today, you enhance the same thing tomorrow, you keep on enhancing until you are convinced that this is the user experience that I'm expecting out of that particular system. Until and unless you are not convinced basis on the user feedback that you have received, you cannot go ahead with actually implementing that particular process, because any mistakes that you commit it at this stage, in the sketching stage. After that, if you commit a particular mistake in the actual implementation and design stage, it would be a huge risk for your particular project and it would be a cost overrun. Then testing and evaluation of wireframes is part of this stage. Whatever wireframes you create, you need to test and evaluate it in this particular stage. Your design team builds initial mockups and share with stakeholders to get their input. Whatever mockups that you create, you have to continually share with your stakeholders to get their input. And throughout the process, it is important to keep your team goal in mind, make a usable design to achieve end user satisfaction. So the stakeholder involved in this stage would be your design team, your product managers, your technical experts. The activities that you would essentially do in this particular stage is generate ideas and work on basic sketches, brainstorming sessions with stakeholders to get their feedback from technical perspective, and redraw sketches and retest them with stakeholders. And the outcome that you would get are sketches, wireframes, mockups, and user flow like this. So essentially, we use the tool Axure or any similar tool for creating the initial sketches, like how the content would be there, whether it would be a collapsible content, whether it would be partially slideable and partially collapsible content, how the user experience would be there, from where, which screen the user should be able to search a particular product. So we need to convey them with the help of sketches. So this is the first sketch, this is the modified sketch. Depending on that, we would explore more and more an option for these sketches. Whichever sketch we feel final, we would go with that user experience process. Now fourth stage is design stage. Now here, now that we have finalized the layout and flow of the required interface with us, the next step is to work on the final graphics. Turn the initial mockups and wireframe to great looking images with themes and styles applied to them. Now, once we are finalized with the sketches that we have, now it's time to design the particular sketches with the help of graphics. Now, for that reason, we would be using different themes and styles. Now, what are themes and styles? Now, themes are like, if my collapsible content is green in color, if I add another collapsible content throughout the application, it has to be green in color. Okay, so that is a style. Now, theme is like, if the width of that particular collapsible content, that is not a relevant example. Theme would be like how the overall screens would look like. If in my home screen, the image is categorized in square box, particular boxes, then in about screen also, it would be in based on that particular theme. The images would be categorized in square boxes. The theme won't change. And style is like your width, your height, your color, your background effect. Those would all be part of your style. Where theme is like the classification and categorization of the content. If you visit a particular website, you would see this particular difference. How the theme looks like and how the style looks like. Now then comes preparing and sharing of design specifications, principles, guidelines, colors, typography, iconography to development team is also part of this particular stage. Now you have to give exact details about the color, the typography, the iconography about the application that you are intending to achieve or intending to build in this particular application to the development team so that they can actually start designing those particular screens. So the stakeholder would be the design team, the product managers, the business manager, the technical experts in this particular case. The activity would be designing your UI images, defining final theme, specification and guidelines required for implementation, the design icons to display on screen, the sessions with the stakeholder to get their feedback from business and technical perspective, and the outcome would be the design images, the detailed design specification like color, theme, styles, guidelines, and the icon. If you visit my particular website, Milestones website, throughout the website, a particular font is used. There is no change on that particular font. So that's the theme that I have applied. If you see the sidebar, every content is divided into small boxes. So that is again a theme of my particular website. If you see the coloring of that particular application is brown in color. So that is again a theme. If you consider the font size, there is a specific font size for header element and the content element. So the font for content would be, let's say, 14. The font for header element would be 16. So that is something pre-configured, and the same process has to be followed throughout my particular website. So this is how your design looks like when it actually comes into picture. If you see this particular design, all are categorized in the similar fashion. The name of the document, the update date, and the size of the document, and the icon of the document, whether it's an Excel file, whether it's an Word file, or whether it's an PPT file. Now, when I select the particular so particular document over here, then this blue rectangle with a tick mark should appear. Irrespective of how many documents I select, this design consistency should be there. If it is a folder, it should be visible in this particular briefcase, which is yellow in color. So this gives me a consistency of the design and the user experience. Now, one more important consideration that you need to do take care over here is you have to relate your design with other application. Now, if you imagine a scenario in this particular application, instead of putting this icon as Word file, which is offered by Microsoft, if you have simply kept it as a circle with symbol with alphabet W, or a circle with X, alphabet X, or a circle with X this alphabet P for a PPT, it wouldn't have conveyed the user, because so far the users are experienced and are in belief that a Word icon or a Word file icon would look like this, or a spreadsheet icon would look like this, or a PPT icon would look like this. So we don't have to disconnect the perception the user have in their mind. So we have to follow the same icon standard that is offered by your Microsoft Office suite, so that it goes easy for user to understand, okay, this is a Word file, this is a Excel file, or this is a PPT file. So we need to understand that as well. When we say we want to stand out from our competition or the competitors, that doesn't mean we would change everything. We have to inherit something from our competitors as well. What is their way of representation of the things, so that user can relate to what they are doing. Next stage is implementation stage. Now, since technical people participate in early stages of the process, they can start implementation while designing phase is in progress. Whatever you are designing, at the same time, parallelly, your development team or technical team can start its implementation. So development team builds back end functionalities first and connect it with UI when they get design artifacts. So whatever under the hood, the core functionality would be there. Meanwhile, you are creating the user experience and user interfaces, they can work on the core functionality. Once you have finalized the user interface and the user experience, they would add that layer on top of their core functionality. So the core functionality is upload a file. Okay, so they would work on how the upload a file would work. Now, what would be the user experience and UI? Like, you would be showing a cloud symbol with the upload button, or you would be showing a green symbol with a progress bar. That is something you can keep on working parallelly. But let the development team work on the core upload functionality. If the file is two files are uploaded under the same name, so should it replace the older file, or should it create a copy of the newer file? So these are some of the core functionality that the development team has to develop while you are creating the UI screen and the user experience. So let them work, and you can start your design artifact, and in the implementation phase, you can give them these design artifacts to work on. Now, here, development teams builds back end functionality first and connect it with the UI when they get the design artifact. It is better that design team involves in this step to help development phase while implementing. It is possible to raise the need of minor changes in design if anything is needed. So in this case, the stakeholder would be the development team and the design team. The activities that you would be doing is implement back end functionality and front interface, and the outcome would be developed UI with complete functionality and experience following the design theme and style. So here, essentially, you would build the code first, and on top of it, when the design is ready, you would add that design or the skin on top of your core coding functionality. The next stage is evaluation stage. Now we have done, ideated all our design, we have created sketches, we have designed, we have implemented. Now it's time to evaluate the core functionality, whether the functionality is working as per our expectation or not, whether the user experience is meeting our expectation or not. So when product features are implemented, the end product is evaluated based on certain factors, like whether the system is usable, is it easy to use for end user, is it flexible and easy to change, Does it provide the desired solution to user's problem? Does the product have the credibility that makes someone want to use it because of the experience it provides? So these are some of the questions that we ask ourselves when we evaluate the particular design, user experience design process. If we find certain improvement parameters in and around these questions, we tend to incorporate these improvements in the next version or next release of the system. Here, design team validates the product in terms of user flow and experience and identify areas where improvements are needed. So the stakeholders which are involved in this particular process are your design team and the product manager. And the activities that you do is go through the flow and feel the experience, perform a comparison of implementation and defined interface. So whatever you have implemented and whatever you have documented in the interface, there has to be a sync in between those two elements. So you have to perform a comparison between them. And the outcome would be user feedbacks, UI audit reports, areas marked where improvement is required. So there may be a situation wherein you are evaluating your particular product and 30% of the user community are unsatisfied and 70% of the user community are satisfied. You cannot force user to get satisfied. It's their wish, it's their choice. So there may be a situation that certain community of users are not happy with your application and a majority of the users are happy with your application. So you tend to go with the majority in this particular case. If your majority of the users are happy, that means your product is successful. Forget about the critic user who has nothing to do with your application. So over a period of time, even these 30% would be converted along with the 70% when they actually start using those applications. So after this last stage, the process will iterate itself, and depending on the required changes, you may have to go through stage 2, 3, and 4. That is sketch, design, and implement. The process goes on until the desired experience and customer satisfaction is achieved. To conclude, an amazing user experience can only be provided by following an iterative design process, which is your user experience design process. So this process, the stages that we saw, the six stages, they are not a one-time process. Rather, they keep on going on a continual basis until the desired user experience is needed, or for that matter, if you have launched an upgraded version of that particular product, then this process keeps going on in continuity. So all your major stakeholder in your company contribute in the process by performing their tasks and duties. This is the only way you can retain your existing user and attract the new ones in this competitive world. So to summarize, we saw what is user experience design, what are the best approaches for user experience design, the overall user experience design, and the underlying six stages in the user experience design process. So in real-time situation also, whenever you are doing some customization for that matter for a particular product, you are adding certain functionality and you feel that your base product is following a user experience standard, then you have to comply with the base user experience standard. You don't alter with that particular user experience standard. Irrespective of the fact that it is a software product and you are doing some customization, your customizations has to be in line with the base product user experience design. You cannot include anything that is on top of it and say that this is my customization. It won't look good because if there is a con if no consistency is maintained between what the base product is and what's the customization is in terms of user experience design, people would get frustrated. They would say the base functionality are working in a particular manner. They are delivering a particular user experience, and your customized product is working in another manner, and they are delivering another set of user experience. So ensure whenever you are customizing or configuring a particular product, do not alter with the user experience design.